I was asked earlier when is going to be the part that's in English, because we have an exchange student here who was a little bit wild-eyed when I told him that most of this, unfortunately, today is in German. But now comes the part that is especially for you, not only. We are very lucky to have here on stage Danna Stern, the mind behind some of the most successful exports from Israel, and very deeply involved in some of the adaptation of hit series from Israel. We not only will be talking about why Israel is such a great exporter of serial storytelling all around the world, because some of the formats you might all have heard from or you might even have seen. We will also talk about how exactly do you guarantee that the format you export to other parts of the world is successful, that you find the right partners, that you find the right producers, that you find the kind of people who connect to your idea and understand what you want to do with it. And so please give a big hand for Danna here up on stage.
Hi.
Hi. Some of the people here might not know what exactly it is you've been doing in Israel, building up Yes Studios, and what the role of Yes TV or Yes Studios is in the last few years and how it has grown. Maybe you give us a short introduction on what you've been doing in your former job.
Sure. And first, I want to apologize because it's such a beautiful day out, and I imagine, you know, being in here while the sun is shining and there's a pumpkin festival, I think, over in the gardens. I so appreciate you being here, really. I wish it was rainy and miserable, but no. Thank you for having me. I just want to say I'm very happy to be here. I just moved to Germany 2.5 months ago. I live in Berlin, and I have so much to learn because I flew here last night instead of taking the train, so I have a lot to learn. But thank you for having me. And it's true, for the last many, many years, more than I care to remember, I've been part of the Israeli television industry. I was grateful to join at a very early age, just when kind of television series were up and coming, when I sort of joined Yes, which is a multi-channel broadcaster, much like Sky is here, in the sense that they're a platform, they carry channels, but they also own their own channels and also produce. I know you guys here are a little late to the game of multi-channel television production. It's usually was and still mostly is a commercial and free-to-air endeavor here. But for us, we started producing just over 20 years ago, so we've had a long time to kind of learn how to work well, and it's definitely a learning curve, learning how to produce and who to produce with and what to select. So I kind of came up in that in the broadcast system. I oversaw content, all elements of that, started as a buyer myself, and in the last, I want to say 6 or 7 years, kind of with the start of the global streaming platforms and really Netflix launching a global service in 2016. I know it seems like it's been here forever, but it really hasn't. It was January. No. it was January 2016. It's mind-boggling to think of how much, you know, has changed over such a short period of time. But that was the first opportunity for us as, you know, Israeli producers to get our shows out there in the original form that they were made, so Hebrew language series. Obviously, we're going to talk about formats. Our success, or the Israeli success in formats, predates that. But that was kind of the big change for me. And then on the back of that, I sold a show to Netflix, which many of you hopefully have seen, and if not, you're going to jot it down right now and you're going to watch it tonight, called Fauda. Season 4 is coming at the end of the year, or early next year, and that was the first Israeli show to kind of make it in the original, you know, Hebrew and Arabic in this case. On the back of that, I opened Yes Studios, which is tethered to the primary broadcaster, so actually Yes owns it fully, but the aim was really to take Israeli ideas, Israeli creators, Israeli IP, and export that into the world by doing, you know, selling formats or selling tape. There was a thing called tape once. I'm sure nobody knows what that is. The original format.
Only the older people here.
Yeah, tape. And so selling the original version or a format adaptation or, you know, helping creators whose stories are already transcending the local market and helping them, and I think we'll get to it a little bit when we talk, helping them kind of cross over globally to find other markets and other partners and just the best platform in which to tell their stories.
And I think for people who are wondering what kind of export hits came from Israel already in the 2000s, shows like Homeland are based on originals from Israel who get adapted into what Homeland became, one of the biggest hit shows on a global level. Other shows like Hostages, they're also with Toni Collette, were also unfortunately only, I think, one season long, but they were also based on Israeli formats.
Yeah,
and I think this is my beard.
That's yours. I think Haken was here before, right? Before the panel before us, it was. Haken.
Yeah.
So
Haken.
When he was at Vox, I think he adapted.
Now at
RTL. So he adapted an Israeli format from us. Yeah. So.
We talk tomorrow about that.
Okay. Yeah. So that was one. So there's been a few here in Germany as well.
But I think this, what we see in the last few years is a. Explosion of
well, we
the
can,
export
we have a slide.
Of, yeah,
I mean,
this
I prepared some slides because I figured we're in a, you know, academic. Yeah, right? Like, you want to see slides, you want to get data, you want to make sure that you're jotting down notes, because otherwise, how do you know you went to school, right? No, I'm kidding. I don't know if it works. We'll see.
We'll see. We have it here, and we have a quick look at the first slide.
And it's an objective, research company that did this. And I was actually surprised. I was at a panel much like this when they presented it. It had nothing to do with Israel. And I immediately stole the data for this because it shows that Israel is the second largest exporter in the world for scripted formats, which is mind-boggling considering our size. We're tiny. We only have 5 channels and only 4 real buyers, as in, you know, networks that can actually commission, some of which are doing, you know, 2 shows a year. And to think that we are dominating in that way is quite phenomenal. So
I think you're sandwiched in between the U.S. and
the U.S. and the U.K.
So,
I mean, by the way, they're in English. I mean, we're in Hebrew. It's a hard language. Nobody speaks Hebrew, and it's hard, you know, to get people to watch your shows, to read the subtitles, to kind of feel, you know, something about the characters, although they come from different worlds and different experiences and different backgrounds, and yet, you know, see something or enough there to want to put their money and take an option and to go on a very long ride at adapting a show into whatever market they're in. I think that's phenomenal.
I think while we wait for the slide, maybe you know when was this turning point when this big demand for Israeli formats started,
and also maybe I have a slide on that too. I came prepared. I think it really, like all good things, it's always a fluke, right? You know, like a lot of things just happen. You never plan them. And I think Israel's foray and entry into the format adaptation space came from a show called In Treatment, Betipul, who I don't think you have here. There is a version in French on Arte, which I think you get is extremely good. I know there's an option in Germany. I have nothing to do with the show, by the way, so it's like I'm happy for the producers.
And I think for a long time it was the most adapted format
the most adapted, you know, certainly drama. It's a half hour, and if you haven't seen it, it's great, but basically the idea, and HBO did it twice, so they did 3 seasons, and they brought it back last year, and I think they're at number 20. I think, you know, if the German version happens, it'll be 20. It'll be the 20th adaptation, but that show has been going on for almost 16 or 17 years, and it was, I just happened to be in LA last week, and I finally heard the story from the guy who sold it, from, we can all see you, okay, it's okay, I mean, it's very, yeah, see, promised
here
you
we
a
go.
Slide, oh, there we go, yeah, we can take a look at that. Oh, wow. All right. So Yeah, so the promise slide.
I think
slide.
We have it here in a second.
Yeah, but that's okay. I'll just go like this. It's very, very attractive. But that's really over the last kind of 12 years. And again, it's, you know, it's pretty impressive. I mean, I'm proud. But we can go a little bit, and I think that'll give us, you know, some of that huge. We'll keep that up for a little bit.
Yeah.
These are just some of the examples of. These are all Israeli shows. I didn't do like multi-version language of it. I mean, there's some shows here that, you know, like in treatment, there's 20 versions. Your Honor, there's 10. You know, there's multiple versions, all of which are Israeli. There's one that doesn't have like a name on it. It's coming up. It's called Echo 3. It's a show that'll be on Apple with Mark Ball, adapted it. He did Zero Dark 30 and Hurt Locker. Obviously, so that's an adaptation of an Israeli format that's coming. Yeah, these are all, I mean, the caliber of people that we get to work on our adaptations is amazing, but we'll talk about that a little later. We'll keep that on. But In Treatment was really the one that started and kicked it off for all of us, and I got to hear the story from Rick Rosen, who is the head of television at WME, William Morris Endeavor, which is an agency who sold the show, and he said something that, oh, by the way, I will say this, there are a million versions to any success story, so this is just one of them, okay? But that's the one I heard last week, and I like it. But he basically said he was late. He was in the office, and his phone rang, and for some random reason, he actually picked it up. And if you know anything about agents, certainly senior agents, they have like 13 assistants, and they never pick up their own phone. And for some reason, miraculous, he answered. There was an Israeli guy called Chagai Levy who created this and said, hey, you know, somebody said I should call you. I have a show. I think it's really good. Would you like to take a look? And he said, sure, send it to me. These were at the time of VHSs, right? A couple of months later, a VHS, who knows what a VHS type is? All right, okay. But it's big and it's bulky. And anyway, I went to the mirror room and it was shipped and it was on his desk, and of course, he was never going to see it, right? And he said, like, I'm never, let alone I picked up the call, you know, cold calling, and certainly not going to watch, you know, something in Hebrew. For some reason, there was somebody, you know, at his desk that week, about to go on the weekend. She said to him, what's this? Why is this on your desk? And he's like, this guy, random Israeli caller, she said, do you mind if I take it and I watch it? And he said, sure, and she came back after the weekend and said, you have to watch this. This is phenomenal. And he did, and, you know, packaged it, watched it that week, all five episodes. The show is basically a therapist meeting his client four times a week. Every week it's the same client, and on the fifth day he sees his own therapist. That's the format, very formattable. And he packaged it and sold it to HBO within a couple of months. Long story short, Rick is now married to an Israeli. Like, that's how he is, that show changed his life, personally. He became very close to the industry, very much involved, has some great successes, and launched us on our journey.
You touched upon something that I find always interesting when people talk about format being formattable or being easily transferred into something else. And I think what you just did is you really,
if you can explain it in 20 seconds, it's formattable. It.
Yeah. This is the one that
we're looking
for. If you
need 2 minutes, it's not. Let me tell you that. Yes.
And we were trying to do this, try to get it into two sentences maximum with all of these in the office, explaining it to our colleagues, and it actually does work, because these are all formats that you can explain in two, three sentences, and the other person immediately knows what it's about, and everybody fills it then with his own ideas what this will actually be and how that will actually translate into the story. What I find interesting is, are here some shows on there where you were not aware that they're based on an Israeli show? And for example, who knew that Euphoria is based on an Israeli original?
See, you learned something in school today.
That show had
not my show. Some of these are not that one is not, and we're all very, very proud of it. But that is that show had at least three different development cycles in the U.S. until it got to the showrunner that it got to, who really made it his own. And I think that was key. He himself, he's a former addict, a teen child of privilege, and he put a lot of himself into that show, and that's the reason it's so successful. Sam Levinson is just, that's his show. He took the main characters and the name. I have to say one thing. You gotta have a good name. A good name is half the work. Just saying.
On which side?
At both. Always have a good name, right? You cannot believe how key that is and how superficial a lot of people are, that sometimes it'll just be the name. And I can give an example that has nothing to do with this.
I would love to.
But I can give a couple. I'll give one on the format side, which isn't here. It's currently in development. All right, I'll say it. We're friends. Currently in development at Netflix as a global series, English language, called Magpie. The Hebrew version of that is Hamidoviv. That is the one word I cannot find. Hebrew only has like a half a million words. English has about 2 million, so... Usually there's plenty of synonyms in English. This time basically means somebody that prods somebody to speak in a jailhouse. I don't know if you have that here, if it's legal here, but basically like an informant that himself is, you know, somebody who's in jail, and you know, he gets into, they put him in cells and he prods people to speak.
Like a snitch or?
Like I said, but he's not a... He prompts these.
Gets people to get these snitches. Okay.
Yeah, but you're interested already, right? You think, interesting character. But point is, we couldn't, you know, there was no good name for it. Magpie, the bird, has that, you know, it's a very sly bird, it's gorgeous, it steals shiny things, it's very aggressive. Suddenly the show sold. I'll give you an example that has, again, nothing to do with formats, but I used to run programming, and one of the challenges is when you're getting shows, acquisitions, to find a Hebrew name for them. And we had this documentary once that we named, and it was our number one documentary that year as far as viewership goes. We called it The Secret Confessions of a Swedish Nun.
What was it about?
It was about a Swedish nun.
But
a real
really
nun.
Secret.
But what did people think it was about? So... everybody thought, you know, their minds went exactly where we wanted them to go. But it really was a Swedish nun who was, I don't even know what she was making, like olive oil or something. I don't know, something ridiculous. Like not very sexy, I'll tell you that. But that's what people go for. So a magpie is a catchy, you know, and if you know anything about birds, you immediately get those characteristics. If you know anything about Swedish nuns, you're going to want to watch that show. So names.
How big of a role was it for example, for your honor, and how did that evolve to be, maybe you can put up the slide, because we have here.
There we go.
A lot of format adaptions of that show.
That show is mine.
And I think a lot of the shows that we saw earlier, we were very proud at Serienkamp to be able to screen them when there weren't any adaptions yet. And here, I think we also screened in the last few years 4 of those adaptions. So we have a good track record here. But maybe you can tell us a little bit about the show and how it traveled the world then, because I think here the translation between the original and it being remade and adapted in the US and here in Germany was very quick, wasn't it?
Relatively. First of all, nothing's quick in this industry. Just so you know, things take forever and then more time. Like, it's not for the faint-hearted. Any show you're going to be doing, unless you're making, you know, an independent web series, which is awesome and great, or TikTok, those are fast. But this business is, you got to breathe, right? It takes, the German version, I'll tell that story, and we can count off the years. I don't know if one hand will be enough, but we can do that. It takes a really, really long time. So even if you say quick, I mean, it does look impressive, and the show only launched in 2017, which, you know, in our industry is fast, but they're all, like, excruciatingly long to do. Your Honor, actually, the name is easy because Your Honor in Hebrew actually means kvodo, which is what it says, or it says, I think there's an English version in your little thing.
Folder here?
Folder, whatever. So in that case, you know, we already have the title, and I have to say it falls under the category, and you can explain it in 2 minutes. It's you know, a father trying to save his son. And the father is an upright judge, and his son happens to run over the son of a criminal who the father helped put in jail. Things from there, it's a slippery slope. Nobody comes out alive. Right? Good pitch. There you go. Sell. But that was really it. And Your Honor, it started from the U.S. adaptation, actually. It wasn't even shot yet. I had a friend. By the way, this is all about having friends, this business. This is true, you laugh, but this is the way this industry works. It takes a long time. You have to have good friends. That's it, right? And a good title. That's all it takes. But I had a friend who was in LA who was saying, what are you working on? What are you excited about? And I said, this, I think it'll be good. You know, the scripts are good. You never know with production, but you want to read. And he is an Israeli, and he read it, and we translated a few scripts. And, you know, he took it to CBS Studios, who then took it to the Kings. I think you have Good Wife and Good Fight here, yeah. So they produced both of
and
those.
And Evil.
Oh, and... Well, we want to forget that one, but yeah, I don't like that. That's not my, all right, yes, we have Evil. And they took it to Peter Moffat, who is a UK screenwriter, who wrote a fantastic pitch, went out in the US and sold it in the room based on a pitch. So no development, no script, straight to series at Showtime. That has never happened before. First and only time I know that they actually sold it off a pitch in a room, but that was a very competitive situation. Again, a very compelling, very easy to imagine adaptation, right? It's the stakes are, and that was the first one. I'm recalling something that happened in 2016. The show didn't launch till the end of 2020.
Just you
understand
bit, yeah.
The time it takes. And then that was in the works. We had gone to a festival, Series Mania, if any of you go, and you should, it's fun. And we premiered the original Israeli version of Your Honor. That was 2017. We won. That was nice. We won the Grand Prix. We'd since won a couple other times, too, for other shows, but we don't have to talk about, but we can talk about those later. And that gave us, it's important to say because it does kind of give you some visibility. And then, you know, if you're good at your job, you can use that visibility to talk to your friends and get them interested in what you're doing. And that was exactly the case with what happened with Scary One, with Al and the German version. He and I are friends from the film circuit. I used to be a film buyer as well. And he was going into television. He said, what are you excited about? I said, this, because I'm going to France. I'm getting an award. You should watch it. And he had watched it just before we got back to Series Mania to get the award. We had dinner the night before and closed the deal at dinner. That was April 2017. The show premiered in April 2022.
So
5 years.
So
almost to the day, by the way. I make a very...
At this point, did he already have the opportunity to watch it, or was it just
he had
really
watched,
your
So he
your
watched
pitch?
The first two at that point. He totally got it. Also, again, I cannot stress the friend thing. If a friend says to you, and, you know, we don't bullshit each other, right? If I believe in something, I will tell you I believe in it. If I don't believe in something, I'll tell you I don't believe in it, right? There's no way to be successful if you're trying to, like, make a quick buck here. Right, so I think that helps. Certainly, in all these versions, it was the same. I mean, these are all people I'd worked with in the past or will work with again. And you say to them why you think it's right for their market, why a show would work, why is it universal or why it's not universal or super specific, why that world is right for a certain channel or a certain creator. And to Al's credit, in this case, and I'm sure you've heard it before because I know he's been
at Seriencamp conference. Oh God.
Yes. So he's. Certainly told that version, but to his credit, that first dinner, he said, this is a show for Sebastian Koch. He's going to do it. And long story short, he did. So, I mean, that's quite amazing.
How much, when you say that you have to know a little bit the market you're selling it to, for example, for Your Honor, are you involved or do you have an idea which of the channels would be great as a landing platform?
I have to say, this one is interesting because it's very broad and universal and it pretty much all went to public broadcasters. So here it was ARD and ORF, it was RAI in Italy, TF1 in France, so big traditional kind of broadcasters, not a streaming show, All right, and understandably, right? It's got a mechanism, it's got a hook, there's a whodunit element to it, and it's, you know, not groundbreaking format-wise. So I always, you know, and this is true for the producers we work with, I think there was always an understanding this was going to go kind of the traditional broadcast route and not necessarily a streaming show, for whatever definition of a streaming show is. That changes daily, by the way, depending if a streaming show is working or not. So in this case, this really was that. The same for, you know, India. I think we can watch a video because I can breathe and drink.
We would definitely.
But I can, we can show, you know, how, I love talking about television and not showing television. That's not fair. So we can
we
take.
We try to do something against that. And I think we have the clip here. Yeah. With maybe you give a quick introduction about what we're going to see. Okay. And of which versions we're going to see it.
All right. So we're going to see a clip which I badly edited myself. I'm sorry, I am not an editor. Absolutely not. Hopefully it'll get the point across. We're gonna show four versions of this, starting with the Israeli one. Obviously the German one gets the most time, because you'll understand. Russia, I know that's not popular, but that's a whole, it looks a little bit different, and I thought it'd be interesting to see. And then we end with the Indian version. They've already done two seasons. I will give this, I mean, working with the Indian market is challenging. It's very competitive, very intense. But they're the fastest producers on earth. And also the ones, I mean, unbelievable, unbelievable. And also the ones, so they already have two seasons that aired, right? And they're talking about a third. The US is in production on their second season. That's gonna launch at the end of the year. Just so you understand. And they started like 3 years after the US version, and they already have two. They're phenomenal. And I would say also in my experience, the ones that kept it closest to the original. But mm-hmm. We can take a look and discuss it.
See for yourself.
מתי המשכת לנסוע? וככה פשוט השארת אותו שוכב על הכביש?
אתה יודע מי הקורבן?
מי זה?
מי זה? אתה יודע כמה אנשים שלה נכנסת לכלא?
Immer noch, dass du aus der Sache rauskommst.
Мотоциклист.
Что потом?
Ничего. Я просто взял и уехал.
Может быть, убил человека. Надо во всем признаться.
Пострадавший? Личность установили?
Да. Но боюсь, что тебе это не понравится.
Охренеть.
А по какому вопросу?
Заявление подать.
Поступила информация об аварии. Пострадавшим оказался Данил Разин.
तुम्हारा एक्सीडेंट हुआ और तुम वहां रुके नहीं
तुम्हारी गाड़ी से टकरा के एक आदमी एक घायल आदमी सड़क पे पड़ा था और तुम उसे वहां मरता छोड़ के चले आए ये वो बात नहीं है कि तुमने कोई ट्रैफिक का रूल तोड़ा है ये उस आदमी के मरने और जीने की बात है
वो लड़का जो मोटरसाइकिल चला रहा था उसका नाम है सतनाम मुर्की गूगल करके देखो उसका नाम पता चलेगा
मुझे नहीं जाना है पुलिस के पास
मुझसे जो हो सकेगा मैं करूंगा
I really love it when it's also called false honor in India.
We didn't let them call it Your Honor for contractual reasons because of the U.S. version.
Ah, okay.
They really wanted to. Yes. Names are important, see?
Yeah, definitely.
They obviously wanted to call it Your Honor, yeah. And because there was a U.S. English language version, They had to find something else.
What I would be really interested in, how closely are each of those shows involved with the original creators? Is there contact? Is there some kind of cooperation that you try to create, or differs it from territory to territory, from country to country?
I'll answer with an example from another show. I saw a panel with David Shore a few years ago, and he had just adapted very successfully The Good Doctor, which is a Korean format in the US. And they asked him on stage, and they said, so, you know, how closely do you work with your Korean, you know, creator? Like, and he says, I don't know, I've never met him and I've never watched the show. Which is a little extreme. Sometimes they don't actually watch the show. In this case, there isn't that much of involvement. We do try to involve them, you know, and do like a nice handover. I think it's important from a psychological perspective more than a creative perspective. With the US version, certainly that's very high profile. It's Bryan Cranston. It's a very big show. It's a big show for Showtime. They've gone to the set, you know, but it's more of a courtesy. Mm-hmm. Than really having input. I think that's changing. I think that will be changing. I think there's much more room now and an understanding, certainly in the United States, which is still, you know, the important market for any adaptation, is that there are other people that know what they're doing that are not American. And I know I should apologize. I sound American, and I'm dissing Americans. I am not American. I just sound like this. I'm Israeli.
But in that case, you have to have a lot of trust to the people you had your IP to.
You have to trust who you're handing over your format to. And this is a little very premature for you, but there's a lot in this business that's motivated for the wrong reasons, and usually commercial reasons. And there are big groups involved in today in the format and the adaptation business and the production and the global production business. Certainly in Europe, there's a lot of consolidation. And a lot of times, you'll get many of these bigger groups trying to take formats off the market just to buy them, to take an option and not do anything with it. And I call it idiot insurance, but we're not in the idiot making business. And you want to find the right producer who's really going to take your show, find the right creator, find the right broadcaster, you know, produce it well so it actually makes it on air, because otherwise all you're doing is selling options, and that's not a business to be in. So you have to trust and you have to know. You have to do the due diligence and make sure that you understand, that they understand what the show is, what the roadmap is, who they have access to, what talent they've worked with in the past, what relationships they have with broadcasters, how they see the show positioned, you know, have they produced at that level, or have they produced something similar? And if not, are they, you know, secure enough to tell you that they haven't? Which is also good. I've done a lot of shows with very, you know, early or younger production. Al's Company had never done a show before this one. That took a lot of trust. Applause Entertainment that did the Indian version of Your Honor had never done anything before. Now they're huge. Now they're one of the largest producers in India, only in 5 years. Told you they work fast. But passion goes a long way. Knowing what you know and also admitting to what you don't know is important. These are the things I look for when I, you know, hand over and license a format.
So is it for you important that you have a package from the other side that he can tell you these are the people we are looking for to work with, or is there also, I don't know, a little bit of risk involved from your side?
There's a lot of risk involvement. Sometimes they'll have those relationships with them and they'll actually come into fruition. Sometimes they'll say, oh, you know, we have a writer in mind. And sometimes it'll work the reverse. We have a show, which is lovely, called On the Spectrum, which is about three young adults on the autistic spectrum sharing an apartment together. And it's the first show you can actually see what it's like to be an adult with autism versus being a child or being the child of a family that's dealing with autism. Good pitch, right? That's why it's sold. That show also won Series Mania, the grand prize. It's a lovely, lovely show. It's not airing here, unfortunately. I don't think we have any acquisitions people in the crowd, but
it's still open.
It's still available. But I should say that show was obviously special from the second we commissioned it to the first assembly. And it was very clear to me in this case what the roadmap was. And I was much more proactive than reactive in the sense that way before it aired, I was already on the phone with our agency in LA, which is CAA, telling them, this is the show, this is what it's about, this is the list of writers that I need you to get me. And all I did was Google writers with autism, with people with autism. And I was very certain that we needed a writer that had somebody in their immediate family, either a father, a mother, or a sister, or a brother, who is autistic, who is on the autistic spectrum, who is a well-known writer. And I had a few names. Second name was Jason Kadams, who's been very vocal about having a young adult son on the autistic spectrum. He had done several adaptations before Friday Night Lights and Parenthood, so I knew he, you know, was in that business of adapting. Some people are not, but today I would say most people are. And that was it. And I sent it to him. He watched it on a Friday. I was happened to have been in LA the following Tuesday, and we closed the deal over lunch.
Very...
It was the easiest deal, by the way, to do, because he's obviously a creative person and he's a showrunner, a writer. And he had a studio deal at the time with Universal, and he basically called Universal up and told them, you close this, whatever you need to do. And I went there on a Thursday, and I just gave my numbers, and that was that. It was the nicest deal ever.
Very easy to...
Contracts took 2 years, but yeah,
you.
But the deal was, yeah.
But one question that comes up when you look at the current landscape of the streamers, that... it seems much more difficult to get someone involved to do something like this and be open to adaptations in all those different countries, because I think someone like, don't want to name names, but I think Netflix would be not so open to doing adaptations of Squid Game, for example.
They are very open. They just want to do it themselves. They just did a Korean version of Casa de Papel.
Casa de Papel.
Right? These are difficult conversations to have. But everything is changing in our industry, and I have to say I love it for it. And this is the business side. Obviously, the creative changes as well, but not as quickly. The business is constantly, constantly changing. And you know, if we were sitting here 7 months ago, I would have laminated the fact that everybody's holding back formats, right? If you're doing a US version, then they don't want you to do any other versions anywhere else. And if you're doing an Indian version, they don't want you doing another one anywhere else. If you're selling it to a screamer, they're gonna buy out the world and, you know, only have the ability to do it themselves. But, you know, back in April, the bottom kind of fell for a lot of the streaming, with Netflix subscriber numbers not hitting their mark. And then from that, everybody's de-rationalizing streaming. Suddenly HBO Max International is not a thing. Suddenly Paramount's going through, you know, whatever turmoil. Everybody's rethinking streamer, or maybe streaming's not. So it changes, and you have to either hold out or hold your own and hold your ground and say, this is the business that we're in. I don't think it matters to anyone. You know, The Office, right? That's a UK format, ran for 6 or 7 or 8 years, I think, in the US. Who cares? And that's, both of them are English language. So do you really care that there's a French version and a German version? Formats are highly original for their own territory. They speak their own language, they're rooted in their own culture, they speak to their own audiences. There's no danger, really. We're not, you know, in France, they aired at the same time. The US version and the French version aired literally at the same time on Canal Plus and on TF1.
So you're not cannibalizing each other?
I don't believe
only
we are.
Slightly.
I think executives think you are, and in their minds, it is, but for a viewer, think about it yourselves. Does it really matter to you? Would you not have watched, you know, this Ricky
One
Gervais and Steve Carell? Like, and that's English, and by the way, those first episodes are identical. They're literally the same scripts. Most of our stuff is highly, you know, localized. I don't think that changes the enjoyment. I think people are going to watch a local language show on a big, you know, local network or even on a streamer. It's not going to matter to them if there's an English version. It's certainly not going to matter to you if there's an Indian version. The chances of you finding it, let alone knowing about it, are, you know, minuscule. Does it matter that there's a Korean version? Really?
For most of the audience, especially the audience I know, sometimes it's more of an incentive that you watch something because I want to see how it's adapted and how it changes in that regard.
You know, I think there's room for them all. I think, and if you do them well, they're very local anyway. And so there's no cannibalization for me, but the conversations are very hard. They're prolonged. Sometimes you pull a format. Sometimes you don't make a deal in those cases. I've not done those deals at some point.
But something that might be interesting to us certainly is when you go back to where we're starting from, that shows from Israel have a certain appeal to a global audience, and if you look at the numbers, that they export so well to other territories, to other cultures. And I asked a lot of writers, producers, what they think is this secret sauce or what's behind it.
Let's go to the slide, the next one, and I'll put it.
You have the power for the slide.
I have the slide. All right, I have the power. This is something I wanted to kind of show, and that's the timeline. And you had asked if our showrunners and creators are involved, and I said I think that's changing. And while we're very, very successful in the format business, I think Israeli creativity, to your point, and what is in the sauce, is getting more recognition than that. So there's an understanding that it's not just about formats. And this is a little timeline, just kind of to show the way that we've progressed, at least as an industry, from really starting out with just Bitipul is in treatment in 2005, just seeing for our formats adaptations, Prisoners of War, that was Homeland, or becomes Homeland. In this case, after the great success of Homeland, Hulu had actually picked up the Hebrew language version, and that was the first time. Then, of course, is Fauda, which is it was the first one to air in its original, no format around that success, just pure. Somebody saw it, an executive at Netflix, and said, I think this has a shot at being a global show, and certainly, he was right. After that, we're seeing Our Boys. I don't know if you've seen it here. Our Boys is a commission that HBO in the US, this is not HBO Max, this is not an international channel. After the success of Fauda, came out and said, all right, there's something in the Middle East, we want to commission a show. And it's a great thriller about the abduction of three and subsequent murder of three young Israeli yeshiva boys, but it's really about the retaliation and the lynching of a Palestinian boy on the back of that. And it's a mystery, it's a political thriller, if you will. It's Hebrew and Arabic, and it aired on HBO in the US. And I think that's they commissioned it. It was not for an Israeli channel. So that's another, if you can think of HBO commissioning a German show, it's kind of the equivalent of that. And then, we kind of, Tehran, that's an Israeli show that airs on Apple. It's available here as well. That was already pre-construed, I think, a little bit as an international show, for whatever that's worth. So Hebrew is actually the third spoken language. It's Farsi, English, and Hebrew. And that's a thriller. It's on Apple everywhere, and they're going to continue with the show as long as the creators kind of make it. Hit and Run is the same folks who did Fauda. Now, that was a show that was half English and half Hebrew. So you can see there's like a commissioned by Netflix. You can see kind of a natural transition of just formats to really kind of show running, writing, and working directly with, the platforms and the streamers. After that, Scenes of a Marriage was this year, but that's show run by an Israeli. That show has nothing to do with Israel. It's based in New York. They're as American as they can. It's a Swedish show to begin with. And that's already, HBO's going to an Israeli writer and saying, you can show run this huge show with Jessica Chastain. It's phenomenal for us. It's an unbelievable opportunity for talent. And I think that's why I think it's changing. I think there's a realization that you don't necessarily have had to grow up in, the States in order to run a show. And certainly I feel that more and so in Europe. I think here you're very good about getting, crossing borders and getting directors. By the way, the conceptualizing director of Your Honor is German in the US at Berger.
We invited him here, but he unfortunately he has
a little movie
right now.
Oh, I thought he had a movie to launch. Okay. but yes, so I mean, I think that's changing. So that's good news for you because you don't have to work in this market, and hopefully, your ideas can transcend, and there is an openness in becoming. And then the last example I have here is a show that launched in early October on Sky called now it's called Munich Games.
It
was called
they changed the name twice, I think.
Yes, it was Munich Match, and which is an Israeli, Michal Aviram, who worked on Three Seasons of Fauda. She's a screenwriter who had an idea for a show that, you know, couldn't be made in Israel. I actually introduced her to her production partner, to Amelie, and from there they took it and made it into a German show. And many places have said it's a co-production. There's no co. It's a purely German production with an Israeli writer, showrunner.
So you think there's an atmosphere of opening up to ideas from other territories?
I know it. I feel it every day in my work.
And do you feel that compared to other parts, that maybe here in Germany it's a little bit more still closed, or that the market is still more self-contained? I know you only
I've only been here for 2.5 months. I have no idea. I wouldn't presume anything. I think, look, everybody's watching everything now to an extent, right? You've all watched, you know, a Korean show in the past year. Some of you might have watched an Israeli show. I'm sure you watched French Rose. I watched Cleo. I love it, right? I mean, that's a whole, is that not a good thing to say? Or do we not like it? I like it. It's a couple episodes too long, but I like it. But, you know, so I'm saying there is an appetite and a realization that, you know, the cliche is really stories do come from everywhere. And now the realization is that storytellers can come from everywhere. And I think that's important.
The question still, do you think there are some factors that, don't know, you prepared a slide.
Because I have a slide. Right, it's the last one, I promise. It's not a. But people do ask that and why. And Israel has had a head start in everything that we're talking about. And the fact that you can get a writer here to run, to do a show for Sky is, you know, you don't see, I don't know, I don't want to diss any other country, but you don't often see that. And we do have had a leg up. We did start producing fairly early, as I mentioned, you know, around 20, 25 years ago, on not just the state broadcasters. So much more freer on, because of the regulation that we have to spend 8% of our revenues into Hebrew-speaking production. And since that applies to everyone, including the kind of premium pay platforms, it's much more liberating as far as the kind of forms and formats and subject and topics that you can touch. So you don't have to fit into the, you know, 9 p.m. hour and a half slot on the weekend, a three-parter murder mystery that you have to find out who did it on a Sunday night, otherwise you're not going to go to work on Monday morning show of some countries who shall not be named. But we don't have that, right? So we didn't have that. So we had much more leniency into the type of topics that you could write about, that you could produce, the stories that you could tell. And they didn't have to be big, and they didn't have to be small, and they certainly didn't have to be tropey. So it wasn't like a lawyer show and a cop show and a hospital show. And there's a lot of trial and error, but we knew that was money we had to spend, and I'm speaking from the broadcast side here. It was money you had to spend anyway. Why not have fun doing it? And thankfully, that met you know, Israelis who are natural kind of storytellers. I think there's something inherent. I mean, you see me waving my arms around. Like, it's cultural. And there's a certain energy, and we're very sharey, and we're oversharing, and, you know, we're very welcoming. And we will tell you, if you give us a minute, you will, you know, hear our tale. So there's something in that. I think it is a cultural. Also, you know, there is a cultural difference, and there are other countries who are not, or other people who might not be as open. We also live exceptionally interesting lives. Everybody comes from somewhere else. We're a country of immigrants. You know, we're all second, third generation, some first generation immigrants. We've all been through a lot. We all come from very different places, from North Africa, obviously, Europe, Central Europe, Eastern Europe, Western Europe. I mean, it's everywhere. We're a hodgepodge of everything. We go through wars and elections and terror attacks and, you know, just everything all at once. The thing I find most interesting about Berlin is how quiet it is. Israel has like a volume to it. It's just something's always going on. Somebody's in a rush to do something. So that intensity, I think, also leads to it. And I put it a little bit about the slide, but we really are, you know, we're passionate. We have a voice. Most of our shows are based on experience or personal experience. Fauda is certainly based on experience of Avi and Lior, who were undercover soldiers in the Israeli military. in, you know, on the spectrum. Danna Dicis, who created that show, her brother is on the autistic spectrum. I mean, these are things we write about. We write what we know. Certainly for projects, I would say first and second projects, that's almost always the case. Later on, you kind of run out of ideas, and then you might have to, you know, tap on a friend. But it's passionate. It's intimate. It's intricate. It's different. It shows that are not the traditional storytelling way that people have been doing shows, at least in the West. I can't speak for all the world. I think that's a big thing. But at least certainly the Western markets have tend to be much more formalized and much more formatable, where we as, like, come to us with your story, with your background, with your passion, and, you know, we'll give you a canvas to do it. The other thing is we don't have a lot of money, so I think we're very creative. We don't spend anything on, you know, effects. We shoot everything on location. We don't have sound stages. I know, shocking, right? Funny story, there's a movie that was a co-production, Foxtrot is a co-production with Germany, and there's beautiful scenes in that of a Tel Aviv apartment, which was actually shot on a soundstage in Berlin, Bandung. So I always find that it's a gorgeous Tel Aviv apartment on a soundstage here, because we don't have soundstages. So I call it realistic production aesthetics. It just makes the look of the show a little grittier. It really means we don't have a lot of money, but it does, you know, go to that DNA. So people write for story, and they write for dialogue, and they write for character versus writing for background and scenes and setups.
Does that also mean that you have to solve certain problems on the page and not on the set?
All the time. And I think one of the things, as we're transitioning and taking a lot of our writers internationally, one of the things that we keep pointing out and saying, you know, stop also being the producer. You don't think about, you know, can this scene be filmed? Will the production have enough money to do it? You got to put that aside and, you know, transcend that and try to tell maybe a bigger story, because you don't necessarily have those constraints, those financial constraints. But when you have them, you know, not having a lot of money sometimes is a good thing. You become more creative and you dig deeper and you find the story from within and from within the characters versus, you know, throwing it out.
Showy stuff to be out there.
Yes. You know, world-changing, exploding helicopters.
I get the sign that we're unfortunately running out of time, and so I didn't give you all the chance to pose your questions, but I think you'll be here.
I will say
one
thing that I forgot to say. We have a ton of film and television schools, by the way. Like, that's part of it. I think we have more film schools per capita than anywhere in the world. We have 60 different film and television programs in the country of 8 million people, just saying. So 60. Something crazy. It's crazy.
This is a little bit crazy.
So that's part of it. That helps, too.
But
not doing questions?
If you want to do questions, maybe later you find Danna outside and kind of have a one-on-one question-answer session, because I think there, I saw some hands going slowly up, but unfortunately we have to keep it a little bit on schedule. So thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
And a big round of applause, please.